About 8 years ago, in the UK, I was outed by a mental health charity because they asked me if they could take a photo of me to raise money in one of their little, you know, pamphlets. And I said, yeah. And I thought it was going to be a tiny, you know, tiny fingernail clipping of a picture. But there were huge posters all over the UK, gigantic. And I looked like a Lithuanian peasant. And it said on it, one in four people have mental illness. One in five people have dandruff. I have both. I mean, you know, mortified. So I thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to write a show, and I'm going to make that look like it's my publicity poster. So I did write a show, and I did it in mental institutions for the first 2 years. And I think they liked it, but I couldn't tell because they weren't always facing me. And then I made a joke. I said, the bipolars used to say, I laughed, I cried. And really, if you can make a psychotic laugh, you're halfway to Broadway. What happened was then we would have, I would do my show, then we'd have a little bit of a lunch break, and we used to steal food from the anorexics, because they didn't mind. And then we'd come back, we'd have a discussion, fabulous discussions. I won't even go into their questions. But, and oh, P.S., I wasn't talking down to them because they knew I was of the tribe. Okay, so you know how people go, how'd you do that? I was one of them. So then the show took off, and I did it in all theaters. In Australia, in Cape Town, in London, everywhere I did this show. And the audience would ask me the same questions. And it became a kind of, even for 1,000 people, one guy would stand up and he'd say, you know, real butch guy, I've been on antidepressants for 20 years. I've never told my wife. And she was sitting next to him. And it was like the Muppets in there. Like people would be beside themselves. You know, where do I go? How do I get help? And sometimes it was heavy. You know, one woman said, I have cancer and depression. And I said, well, which is worse? And she said, well, with the cancer, all I wanted to do was live. And with the depression, I just wanted to die. Other people were quite funny. So this became a walk-in center. And on my days off, I would use it as a walk-in center, and I'd bring in doctors and neuroscientists and invite people off the street and have a whole army of therapists so they could get help. Bully for me. We needed a kind of AA, have it so organized. And this is like, you know, how they get it together. They're drunks. So I made this a walk-in center. And then what happened was I had a depression. It doesn't define my life. 7 years ago, I had a really bad one. I ended up on a kind of a chair for a few months. Let me just say, people think I'm just going sideways, that depression is about having a bad hair day or your cat left out. It isn't sad. Nothing to do with sadness. It's like your old personality slowly leaves town and you're left with a block of cement, which is you. I mean, it's like being in hibernation, but you can't wake up. And so I ended up in a chair. To take a shower was unimaginable. I didn't tell anybody, didn't tell my friends, because, you know, what comes with this disease is a real sense of shame. Because everybody thinks, well, look at you. You know, you have everything. You're not in a township. You're not being carpet bombed. So I always say you get these abusive voices, like, but not one voice, but 100,000 voices. Like if the devil had Tourette's, that's what it would sound like. So I was sick. I never told anybody. I got a few phone calls from a few friends saying, perk up. Yeah, perk up, because I never thought of that. So then I was really interested in how the brain works, because I thought, well, every other organ in your body can get sick and you get sympathy except your brain. So I thought, let's learn about the brain. So I gave up my career, kissed that one bye-bye, and decided I would do research as to how this baby works, because we know so much about technology, but we know nothing about the mind. You know, it's running us. We're not running it. So I decided, okay, let's do research and find out how I can maybe control my chemicals, you know, how I could cool the engine. So I researched it, and mindfulness-based cognitive therapy had the best results. Otherwise, I would have gone on a workshop for how to hug your inner elf. You know, I'm not into the fluffy stuff. So because of the empirical evidence, I studied. So I found the founder, one of the founders. He was a professor at Oxford. So I have the drive of a Rottweiler. So I drove to Oxford. It was at the time I was sick. I think I smashed into some trees on the way. When I got to him, I was crazy. And I said to him, just tell me in a nutshell, what happens in the brain? What happens in the brain when you do this mindfulness? Because I don't want to wave crystals. He said, you'd have to get into Oxford and get your master's if you want to know about the brain. So I did. And I graduated in September. And I got the bat wings and, you know, the Hogwarts hat. And so it made my life so much easier because of this thing called neuroplasticity, which I don't understand why it's not shouted from rooftops, that you can change the wiring in your brain by changing how you think. Basically, we used to think we were at the mercy of our genes, but you know, like how you come into the world is how you come, how you go out. I mean, look, the length of your leg and the color of your eyes, those you inherit, there's no question, because I'll never forgive my parents for giving me the legs of a dachshund, because I wanted to go down that catwalk. And now I've come to terms, it ain't gonna happen. But the genes that develop your brain, they keep changing because they're dependent on experience. So it's like they hand you a blueprint and a deck of cards, but how you play them is up to you. So, you know, I can't understand why other people don't know this information. I mean, it's 2014. 2014, I have a girlfriend who sent me to somebody to tell me about my past life. I don't know if you know this, but I was a window cleaner in 1742. Everybody else, Nefertiti, I'm a window cleaner. I'm thinking, it's 2014, this stuff is available. Where's the public on this one? Like, ask me about my star sign. What the hell are you talking? They know, you can look in a brain with a brain scanner and see those neurons wire and unwire, and that corresponds to how you think. And every time they wire together, you're laying down memory. But the good news is you can unwire them and create new habits and give yourself a more flexible or happier life, whatever that means. I mean, you're the architect of your own brain. It's known as neuroplasticity, which was so hopeful to me. So I always say Gloria Gaynor was wrong when she sang that song, I Am What I Am. You're not. You have many possibilities. So she's going to have to change those lyrics. Because what rhymes with neuroplasticity?